Welcome back to part two in our three-part series on why tools catch. And I want to talk about tools that have more than one edge. Typically, parting tools and skew chisels are the ones that we think about. So I just got a piece of wood up between centers, and I'm going to start showing you some things about skews. And then I am going to turn this and put it into a chuck. And making a tenon is a parting tool and skew chisel cut anyway. So I'm going to have a chance to cover a couple of things there. So I have a number of skew chisels. This one I have, Alan Lacer made for me a number of years ago. And my sense is that this is more for demonstration purposes. I don't make porch columns, so this is a bigger than I would tend to use. But I do tend to use skews of many different sizes. These both are popular of mine. But even the small ones, and even smaller. They all are going to behave the same way, but these smaller ones are going to have much more of a personality to them, and we're going to require a little more attention to rubbing the bevel, as we say. So let me start off with the first cut we ever show with the skew chisel in our classes, which is called a planing cut. And for that, we typically are using a regular skew, which has a look like this with a straight edge. But also there's skews that have a radiused edge. And for planing cuts, the radiused edge skew has some advantages. The advantage is it has no points that are going to catch on the piece of wood. So when I make a planing cut, whether the toe is up or down, the two corners of the tool are farther away from the wood and less likely to catch. Let's just make a quick cut here and see what that looks like. Just in the center of this piece of wood, from here to here, you can see the little trails of where I ended, and I can see the difference in surface. You also saw that I was moving pretty much my whole body. I had stiffened this triangle between my two arms, and most of the motion left to right was with my feet and my legs. When you start moving this, this is the chance that you risk getting that catch when you come up off of the surface against the wood and get the edge too close. Two kinds of catches with the skew chisel, both of which will tell you exactly what happened. First one is when I bury the edge in. Let me see if I can do that. Not well, but I did it. Let me try it with a different tool, see if I could do it even better or worse. Oh yeah, that's good. When I bury the edge in, I go down underneath the fibers so far that either it's going to tear the wood out or it's going to just stop cutting because the force I can exert forward is not enough to overcome the bind between the fibers of the wood. And you get this curly effect like that. Well, the other one is when I catch one of the corners in the wood. I'm coming along here doing a nice little plane. And you see I'm reluctant to do that, but that's how I did it. I'll try it again. You know, I have a hard time making myself do a catch. But what happens is when the corner of the tool gets into the surface of the wood, you tear out a divot. So if a corner catches in the wood, I have a divot. If I have buried the edge, I have this curlicue. See, if you cut too deep, it's burying the edge, and you get this kind of a roll-up effect here. I've gone down underneath the surface. So the trick here is I've raised my hand too high and caused the tool to cut too deeply.
I overcome it?
By putting more force, remember down, forward, and the lathe is moving at the constant power in this direction. But I was able to force it. So if I take one of these smaller tools, I have the same. Ooh, a little too deep for that small tool. And that's catching the top corner. So let's see how those two differ. Well, on this piece of wood, they don't look that much different. But here the tool went down in, and here the corner of the tool caught. So the two types of catches with the skew chisel are those kind. And if I go to a very small tool, catching, and I think my wood is soft enough that it won't allow me to do too bad of a catch. That's interesting. Now the value of the radius skew, I'm talking about it just cutting. I'm not talking about using these things as scrapers. In part three, we're going to talk about scrapers, and you will see these tools again in that part in a different mode. Now, I want to put this in the chuck so I can show the next set of action. So I need to create a tenon here that'll fit in the chuck. Typically, we'd use a parting tool, maybe to take this down, or we can also use a skew chisel with the point leading forward and the tool flat like this. This is called a peel cut, and is a perfectly safe cut to make. Not very attractive, but it does work. It's very irregular end right now. Let me just square that off. If you're watching closely, what you're seeing is that I am rubbing the bevel of this tool. And as the wood gets smaller, I have to continue to raise the handle, continue to rubbing the bevel. Now, I did two things. I kept that bevel, and it's the part of the tool here that's clean against the wood all the time. But as the wood got smaller, I had to advance. As the wood got lower down, I had to follow it. But I'm following this like the jelly roll, unwinding a jelly roll, following that path down, spiraling towards the center. Could I have done that with another tool? A parting tool? This one laying right here, create my tenon. Now, this is also a double-edged cutting tool. I'm rubbing that bevel, and as that piece of wood gets smaller in diameter, I'm keeping that against the touched against the wood. Same as I do with the skew chisel. Too many times we see, I don't see many catches with a parting tool, but I do see badly cut surfaces. I see people rub the bevel to start, and as the piece gets smaller, they just continue to go in with the tip of this, converting it from a cutting motion into a scraping motion. And that's not good. Now let's assume that needs to be cleaned up a little bit. I could come in here with my skew chisel from the end, clean that surface up. Suitable for squaring it off. And in that motion, I was not cutting. I was actually scraping, as I'm doing on these two corners here, just to make them so I can't cut myself. So I can put this now into a four-jaw chuck. And by the way, I am using that safe drive like I did in the last video. So let's take that out and mount my four jaw chuck. I'll mount the same piece of wood back in the chuck using the tenon I just created. And I want to make sure it's good and tight. If I can move the handle on the tightening tool, then I will. I can't move it anymore, I'm done. There we go. How well did we mount? It's running fairly true. This end is not true. We do that. So I'm going to clean up the surface real quick. I'm going to take skew chisel. The surface was irregular, and I'm not pushing hard against the wood. I'm simply allowing the tool to hit the high spots, only the high spots. And as it gets round, I hear the change in the sound from something that sounds like that to something that's a continuous sound. And now that piece is round. Now I can square this off again with a skew chisel using that same cut. This is the peel cut. Finish that. Actually, I had the tool rest a little too hot. But that end is squared off. And that was rubbing the bevel. Any other tool will do this thing? Yes, a parting tool could do this cut. But you have to follow the curve of the wood. Now, I already know that tool rest was way too high. I'm touching the bevel. There's the cut started, and as the tool goes forward, having to raise the handle to maintain contact with the bevel. I don't want to come down here and get a place like this and it's turned it into a scraper. There is another cut that we do with the skew chisel that gets a lot of people in trouble, and it's an end cut where I'm going to come along here with the tool. Really clean that surface up. And what happens here to get a catch is this whole bevel touches and this whole edge is engaged with that surface. It's not okay. I need to clear this tool back a little bit, maybe about a degree or two, not that much, but just enough that the part of bevel touching is right behind that point and only that small area. Creates a really great surface because it's cutting across those end fibers cleanly, and we have almost a glass-like smoothness here. But the catch comes when the whole edge is touching against the wood. It has to clear back with a big tool so you can see it even better. It would look like that. Overstated, but that's the point. So let's clear off that little piece down the bottom. It's a very clean cut, but prone to a lot of catches because too much side of the tool contact. So we talked about double-edged tools and we talked about parting tools. This also is a parting tool. It's a wider parting tool and sometimes referred to as a beading and parting tool, because I can use this tool to do my parting cuts. I can also use it to roll beads by simply taking the corner of this tool like a gouge. It has to roll to follow the cut of the wood. And in this motion like this, it tends to catch less than other tools sometimes in making these kinds of beads. Narrower parting tools catch very less, much less. However, this tool is bound. The high risk here is binding. A narrow tool and a narrow slot cut deeply will end up creating pressure here that will grab the tool. It's a type of a catch, but it's really a friction bind. So you always make overlapping cuts with the parting tool. One cut, second cut, first. And if I don't do the second cut, you get these burn marks. And that is from the tool rubbing against the wood hard enough with enough pressure that I've actually created kind of a smoked surface. So always need those overlapping cuts. There are other tools that work very similar to that. This is a tool that I bought from Craft Supplies England. It is a type of bedan. It's actually used in boxes. It looks as if it's a single-edged tool. It's great for going inside the end of a box, but these peel cuts very nicely because I'm rubbing a bevel and I have a sharp edge. There is a tool that's made in France and in England called a bedan. The difference is simply in the shape of the tool. This is an English style bedan where the sides are parallel. French style bedans, these two sides cave in a little bit here. It's more trapezoidal. This is double-edged. One surface, a very slight edge coming back on the other surface. Using it like a parting tool there. With practice, which I have not got, I could actually do beads with it. Bedan, also another tool. Catches with this will only happen if the tool is turned upside down and used backwards, where I do not have the big bevel to support it. It can be used in that plan, in that matter, but with a great deal of practice. I want to show you one last tool. This is, in essence, a double-edged cutting tool. This is a beading tool that's made by D-Way Tools, so they come in different sizes. There's a bevel here. And there's this bevel, angled in on both sides. And it's used with the edge aiming down.
and cuts by rolling it side to side. And you can see the cuts going in, and I keep rolling until the top of the thing is round. And I have a bead.
That's a pretty nice looking bead. But it's also bevel rubbing tool. The bevel is here and here. A lot of support on the tool rest, and this rocking motion drives one of these corners in, then the other corner in. I'm not aware of anybody having catches with this tool, but it is possible. Back and forth. But I think the wood can fail. The wood failed. It's chipped off right here. This is soft wood. The fibers just couldn't support it. Is for the surface of this bead to come round. It's flat until the center of the tool touches it. So these are tools that are forgiving. These are tools that cause you some problems. And the big issue is always whether you are rubbing the bevel. If the bevel comes off the wood with the skew chisel, the edge goes in. If the edge of the bevel comes off and the tip goes in, both those situations create a potential catch. And the practice on that is between centers with one of these safe drives, which is the easiest way to practice. And when you get a catch, the wood stops. You can immediately look and see what happened and correct that for your next cut. So I hope this helps a little bit. Part three coming up, which is about scrapers. It'll be interesting from the standpoint we think of scrapers one way. I may present a couple ideas that view the scrapers with a little different light. We'll see you in part three.